I wish getting rid of a body was as easy as in Sweeney Todd or other whorish tales. Just use the corpse as a main ingredient in a recipe, sell it to oblivious customers who will leave the place licking their fingers, and that's a wrap. Hell, I also live in a flat just above a chicken burger shop, and after seeing the hygiene of the place, trust me when I say I am quite sure that not only selling human meat wouldn't be beneath them, but also the human flesh wouldn't even be the most disgusting thing in their burger. So yeah, I wish it would be that easy. Unfortunately, that's just not practical, is it? I mean, for a starter, butchery isn't a joke. It's both hard and time-consuming labor. Then there's the problem of the waste. Skin, hair, eyes, teeth, fingernails, and toenails. Not to mention the entire human skeleton. When you think you gotta get rid of all this stuff anyways, you might as well skip the butchery part and just get rid of the whole corpse. Just stick to chicken. Which is the only reason I know why that going into the shop downstairs and start pitching for them to add a human burger to their menu would be a waste of time. There was a rumor about them using pigeons in their burgers instead of chicken. You know, just because catching and using fauna available just around their shop is cheaper than buying a stack of meat. But I know that's bullshit. For the same reason I know they wouldn't use human meat, it's not practical. Catch the pigeons, catch enough to run a burger shop, catching them when no one's around to see you, then turning it into a burger? It's just easier to buy the meat. Then, whether the meat is actually chicken or they're just so petty they actually found a place selling them pigeons' meat, I can't say. But I digress. The point is, getting rid of a corpse without anyone knowing isn't a joke. That's why you should call a professional. You should call me, for example. I'm sorry I turned everything into a self-promotion, but it's not like I can just advertise on social media, can I? Also, in the trade of ending a human life, there's some classism. What I mean is that murderers, killers, assassins, and hitmen are so celebrated by our culture. Think of all the books and films about serial killers, or murder investigation, how the killer has to make sure to have an alibi and don't leave any proof behind. Nobody ever gives a toss about us poor fuckers having to get rid of the body afterwards, which is unfair because we're risking jail too, you know? Think about video games, for instance, Assassin's Creed and Hitman. In fact, they also made a video game about the guys who cleaned the room up after a homicide, for crying out loud. I'm still waiting for someone to make a game about us. Let me tell you two things about myself. The first thing you should know about me is that I live in Turin, in the northwest of Italy. Things for which Turin is famous, among others, include the Mole Antonelliana, which is to Turin what Big Ben is to London, having been the first Italian capital before Rome got the title, the Fiat car factory, the T in Fiat stands for Turin, or Torino in fact, being the city where the Italian job is set alongside London, being the city where the famous breadsticks have been invented, being the city where Nietzsche wrote Esse Homo, Twilight of the Idols, and the Antichrist, and being the most magical city in the world. When I say the latter, I don't mean the most romantic city in a starry-eyed fashion. I mean the most magical city, quite literally. It seems, in fact, that the world has a black magic triangle, with at its points Turin, London, and San Francisco, and a white magic one as well, with at its points Turin, Lyon, and Prague. I swear. Wikipedia that. As you might have noticed, Turin is the only city in both triangles. Apparently, that's because, and after this I will conclude my history lesson, I promise, when the Romans founded the city, they split it in two. The east side, where the people lived, and the side where the sun rises, and the west side, where they used to crucify and bury people, and of course, the side where the sun sets, allowing the darkness to take over. If you believe in this thing, Piazza Castello, the square where the former royal castle stands, is where the border between the east and west sides of the city is found. More precisely, the actual gate to the castle is the border between the black and the white side. Basically, Turin is quite literally the table upon which good and evil are arm wrestling each other. The second thing you should know about me is that I suffer from anhedonia. In layman's term, a condition which doesn't allow you to enjoy anything because, be the pleasure physical or psychological, you won't feel it. For example, there is sexual anhedonia, whereupon boys can come but without the feeling of pleasure, which, unless you're donating sperm, makes the whole ordeal quite fucking pointless, doesn't it? And then there's the social one, where you don't get any pleasure from socializing. Different from social anxiety, because you simply don't give a shit. And so on. Very soon you stop desiring things, because if you won't enjoy it, then what's the point? So, long story short, I live in total and complete apathy. I could tell you much more about me, but nothing too important since it doesn't matter to me. I live on the battlefield where paradise and hell are battling, and I still can't give a toss, quite literally. The reason why I moved from Turin to England is exactly because it is the most magical city in the world. Maybe, just maybe, I can find a way to feel again. I've basically just moved. It's been only a couple of weeks. And you might call it a very long shot, but it's still better than nothing. My soul, in exchange of coming back home pissed off about the traffic and then wank angrily to calm myself down. Fuck it. My soul just to have a proper enjoyable wank. Right now, I do it every now and then just to drain my balls enough so they don't burst. It feels like I'm shooting sperm away from me in the same fashion you would shoo a raccoon off of your porch. Now, having moved to Turin, I need, of course, a job. So, I thought, why not work in a field that's necessary, but still with very little competition? For example, a job useful to many, but upsetting for anyone working in that trade. Anyone, that is, without my innate inability to feel upset, or to feel anything else. That's how I decided that making corpses disappear would be my bread and butter. I mean, look at it from a logical point of view, which you tend to do with my condition. And let's just crunch some numbers. How many homicides just in your country last year? All these killers, I'm pretty sure, would prefer not to be caught with the corpse fruit of their labor. Now, let's say you are one of those killers. I'm not even suggesting you're evil. Let's just assume you came home when a burglar is in the house and he runs away as soon as he hears you, but trips on the stairs and breaks his neck. Now, the dude is dead in front of your entrance door next to your shoe rack and you haven't even touched the guy. How many of your friends are graphic designers or photographers? How many instead make a corpse disappear as a profession? Now, last question. Would you pay more for the guy who designs the poster for the next time you'll play the flamenco guitar at the open mic, or the guy who makes the stiff cadaver vanish from the foot of your stairs and save you from appearing in court on a charge of manslaughter? Exactly. Now, as they say, advertisement is the soul of business and all that jazz. Unfortunately, any catchy slogan won't make the law turn a blind eye to the operation that helps you make the corpse of your boss disappear after you decided that the last time you said, "If I don't get a raise in 6 months, I'll kill him," was actually a factual statement. On my first week here, I spent my time walking around hospitals pretending to be a priest. "Don't you have any shame?" I hear you asking. Unfortunately, I don't. I have a condition. I wanted to basically find some poor terminally ill bastard and tell him or her I'll help make their remains vanish once they said goodbye. If they wanted to say goodbye before natural causes occur, that is. I told everyone that there was a made-up passage in the Bible which clearly expressed that suicide was okay if you're suffering from an unsurmountable malady. To be fair, the Bible is full of passages that people ignore, so it very well may be. Nobody really trusted me, though. I think it's because of my English accent. I think people thought that I was a Protestant priest mole trying to steal their souls from the Catholic Church or something. I stopped before they called the police. In the end, I had to cave in and advertise on the dark web. The dark web is very weird. I mean, it's technically legal, except that you can't score Tor, the anonymity network that hides your identity as you surf the web, by surfing Google for 2 minutes and then you find blogs, videos, and entire websites feeding you the information on how to. Dark web for dummies. It's a little like marijuana. They sell you the long Rizla, the filter tips, and even the bong without any problem. To actually smoke it, though, do you want to know what's the best part about setting an illegal professional service on the dark web? Nobody will ask you which school you attended or reference from your previous workplace in order to see how good you were or if your experience checks out. You don't even have to fill a paragraph explaining how your persona fits into the shape of the company's philosophy, but without exceeding the 2,000 character limit. Thank you very much. No equality employment charts asking you who you are, how old, how disabled, and which color are you. Who do you like to shag, and who do you like to pray to? No one really cares if you're married, if you're planning on having kids within the next 2 years, when they ask you to make disappear the remains of the competitor drug dealer. Sometimes I wonder whether I should be scared that an undercover police officer will contact me, only to bust me when I'll show up to operate my magic on the hypothetical corpse that I was supposed to make disappear. Maybe I should be scared of it, in fact. Then I remember that I can't be scared. Nor happy, sad, frustrated, or anything on the emotional spectrum. That's why I have to do it. Truth is that I only moved to Turin for its magic, and that I decided to get into cleaning corpses business to make ends meet. But also, the two things are correlated. Truth is that I found a magic who can make me feel something, anything, but I need a corpse for it to work, or more precisely, I need a heart. You see, I didn't just move to Turin keeping my fingers crossed hoping that a fairy tale would happen. I studied black magic ever since I can remember. Turned out that in Turin exists a building named Palazzo Turucci. It was built around 1677, and what distinguishes it is the imposing big doorway dubbed the Devil's Doorway, or Portone del Diavolo. Supported by four columns, richly decorated with exquisite carvings of flowers, fruit, animals, cupids, and other symbols. On the other hand, its name originates from the bronze door knocker representing the devil with its horns and an open mouth. The final bit of the knocker, the one that's held in one's hands in order to knock, is made up by two snakes, joining their heads in the central point. It is real, I promise. Google Portone del Diavolo and see for yourself. Tradition tells of the story that the door one night just appeared out of nowhere after a sorcerer's apprentice had invoked the dark forces. An annoyed Satan would have punished the man, imprisoning him inside the building, keeping the unfortunate from ever being able to get out. If when I said sorcerer's apprentice, you pictured Mickey Mouse, that's okay. It wasn't him, though. Anyway, to corroborate this urban legend, the theory is that in 1600, just before the doorway appeared on the ground floor of the building, there were headquarters for the first tarot factory. As a confirmation of the black magic being linked to the place, and according to the esotericists, the tarot card that is associated with the devil is the 15th, and during those times, 15 was the building's street number. Also, nowadays, the number 15 bus stops in front of the building, but that is stretching it even for me. Loads of other legends exist, like the French major that, during the French occupation in the beginning of the 1800s, told his coachman to wait for him while he was going to have a quick bite, only to never come out again, and whose skeleton was allegedly found by workers imprisoned and buried standing behind a wall some 20-odd years later. Or the ballerina who, during a party in the 1790s, was stabbed to death by unknown and, the next day, a painting depicting her dancing in the flames of hell appeared in the place, not to mention the sightings of her actual ghost. And last but not least, the definitive proof of evil, nowadays the building is actually a bank. If you ever had an overdraft, you know that's actually fitting. The real story, however, is that Mr. Giovanni Turucci had the doorway made and brought over from France. Except that the legend is actually the real story and Mr. Turucci covered it up. Which is understandable. I mean, imagine it. You just walked into your kitchen tomorrow and the devil just made appear a beautifully crafted artistic piece on your breakfast table. What would you tell your partner or flatmate or whoever? Would you say that you bought it or that the devil made it appear from thin air? I started studying the magic of Turin and got subsequently interested in the doorway when I first found a grimoire about Italian black magic. Ever interested in the dark side, because convinced it's the only feasible hope to cure me, I used to be a staff member at the Welcome Collection at Euston, London. Henry Welcome was this amazingly mustachioed gentleman who lived between the 19th and 20th century and spent most of his life hoarding weird, interesting stuff. His collection is not predominantly exhibited in London as a huge curiosity cabinet. I used to read and handle more than I was contractually allowed in the books in his collection. The ones that I found interesting, that is. The day I found this grimmer that, in a very tiny paragraph, explained how there's a street in Turin where the Occhi del Diavolo, Eyes of the Devil, are located. These are a pair of holes or slots in the ground which were technically used back in the day to ventilate and illuminate the chambers underground. Because of their very singular shape, though, they became infamous for being the eyes of the Lord of Hell. Whatever they are, today the building is yet another bank. The Grimmer was suggesting that if you place a completely black candle, both in wax and wick, in the same space between the eyes and you light it up, using a wooden matchstick, no lighters basically, they will give you knowledge of the spirit's dimension. I googled the devil's eyes in Turin, and they not only are real, but are still there. My next vacation was booked. I'm going to catch a plane to Torino, Italia. Long story short, the story actually checked out, and hence, I went back to England to study Italian and piece a plan to move to Turin together. What happened when the black candle was lit, making sure that nobody was around at 4 a.m. on a Wednesday morning, was that the smoke coming from it became bright red and darted in my lungs through my nose like a predator going for the kill. Then I went through the left eye like I was smoke myself and found myself in those chambers which the eyes were supposed to ventilate and illuminate, doing quite some shit job of the latter, I might say so. I could just hear voices around me. I couldn't really see anything due to both the red smoke and the darkness, but the spirits were communicating with me. What I learned that night is what we call spirits, ghosts, demons, and angels are natural creatures. The only difference between them and us is that they live in a hidden dimension and that they have a couple of senses more than we do. As I said, it's all natural, but fucks with our head. For example, time is the fourth dimension. We know time, but imagine what it would be like to explain time to someone who doesn't have the concept of it. Imagine explaining that there is a dimension that will turn those lively 4-year-old children into decrepit old human beings that'll kill them too. Imagine what it would be to explain the sense of hearing or smell to someone who has never been exposed to the concept. It would all sound like magic. The spirits, for lack of a better word, explained how their extra senses can be transferred to us for a short period of time if we give or sacrifice blood to them. Not because of some satanic shit or because they're evil, but because our blood is the only matter which can bond their abilities to us, even for a short time. When, in history, someone has seen these beings, they actually call them angels. When someone has seen these beings sharing their abilities with us through blood, they call them demons. They are happy to help any human who actually manages to interact with them, because they can see us, but not vice versa, and they're frustrated about it. They explained to me that the eyes have been made by a human being in order to be accepted by other human beings as their own ruler. He would be the only one to know how to use the eyes, black candle and wooden matchstick, and they would all bow to him, believing him a god. This human was the one who made the doorway of the devil too, as an act of cockiness, and accidentally trapped himself to his death while doing so, having spent all the magic the spirits gave him in order to create the door. And finally, they told me that they could transfer one's emotions into me if I could give them one's heart. The heart was important. Not only was it a great bond, being the muscle which actually pumps the blood, but it reacts very well to emotions. A brain is the best, apparently, but it's too impractical to use, being too mushy to be handled and being too pure. Too pure, because apparently this process would give me all the emotions felt by the departed in one go. And too pure can kill you. The place where to leave the heart? Place it inside the ring in the devil's doorway's knocker, like an egg in an egg cup. The spirits apparently turn the doorway into a shrine to themselves after the immediate departure of its creator. After the process of downloading the poor deceased's emotions into yours truly is complete, the heart and the corresponding body will turn into smoke. Yes, a red one. That's when I knew I would be great at making corpses disappear. Fuck those snob burger guys. Also, that would be a way to get my hands on a human heart without actually offing people. I might have zero feelings, but I wasn't raised in a barn either. Then, I was spirited away upstairs on the street level. Fast forward to today when I finally received a job offer. There's a corpse that needs vanishing in a warehouse in the Miafiori district, whoever contacted me says. Half of the money has already been transferred to me. I wonder what happened. Was it organized crime, gangs, a mere accident, vigilanteism? The message doesn't say, and it would really be weird if it did. Luckily, I can't feel curiosity. The idea is that I soon will. I only need a mask, a heavy-duty cutoff tool, gloves, and a mobile with unlimited giga. Also, a couple of old t-shirts I don't like anymore, and a mobile portable power charger. The latter charged, obviously. I packed everything into a backpack, and I left. Finding the place took forever, following the map's blue dot on my mobile screen while pedaling on my bicycle. I'm still half convinced about the walk either to the sting operation orchestrated by the cops or into the actual people who contacted me, only to be beat up and forced to return their money and still do the job. I mean, I'm not in the game for the money, but still. When I finally get to the place, I wear my mask, a fox mask. I wear it in case the cops, gangsters, whoever is inside the warehouse. I don't want to show my face to anyone when I'm walking into a building with a corpse at 1 a.m. The reason why the mask is a fox is merely because that is what was cheap on eBay. Then I wear my gloves, latex, without powder, two on each hand. Nobody's there, not even security, as the email said. The only security is a big combination padlock, which, to the combination, was provided to me, together with the address of the place. The padlock clicks open. I walk in, and there's a poor fucker laying on the concrete floor. I don't know how he died, but there's quite a huge pool of dried sick next to him. Poisoning? I don't know. What I do know is that I connected my mobile on the portable power charger and go online to watch the heart transplant operation video that I've been studying since that fateful night with the eyes and the black candle when I decided to move to Turin. Then, I connect the duty cutoff tool to the closest plug and I start working on the stiff's ribcage. I'm riding my bike to the devil's doorway now, a freshly plucked heart in my backpack, wrapped up in old tees. Note to self, next time get an apron, I'm drenched in blood. I pedal past prostitutes and night drivers. I ride the block of the devil's doorway four times to make sure nobody is around, round and round like a condor. Deep on a Tuesday night, luckily there isn't much activity. I sink my arm into my backpack and grab the heart without actually extracting it from the backpack. I approach the door and then I take the heart out, squishing its base into the snake-shaped knocker which I hold with the other hand. The effect is immediate. Reality around me slows down and I'm like a lightning catcher for feelings. A human life is weird. It's filled with so much beauty and so much shit at the same time. It depends on whether you're half full or half empty kind of person, I guess. Or maybe the bad is so that we appreciate the good, if you want to be cheesy. Either way, it beats feeling fuck all for a little while, I guess. First, I feel all the good emotions, love, hope, happiness, relax, hype, relief. It's intoxicating. 40 and odd years, or however old the heart's guy was, of good feelings shoot up in mere seconds. Then all the bad, anger, sadness, depression, anxiety, dread, fear, guilt, paranoia, frustration, all shoot up in mere seconds after the good, the worst come down in history. I threw up, too. My eyes are tearing up rivers and my cheeks hurt. So does my torso. I'm shaking bad and I fall to the ground. I'm wailing, but I can't help it. It sounds so far away anyway. You won't believe the amount of shit the average person processes through his or her brain during a lifetime. The amount of dark, twisted thoughts and just the mere pettiness and pure evil over nothing a human being is capable of. No, not Jack the Ripper. Us. Me and you. Then I live the moment when this guy realizes he was going to die and it isn't pretty. Then it's time for the physical sensations. First, the good. Every massage, every warm sensation coming in and from the cold, or a fresh breeze in a devastatingly hot day, a fresh drink, a bubble bath, and then a lifetime of orgasms concentrated in seconds. I'm now screaming. Just as good as it sounds, it's actually too much. I'm holding on not to faint. Luckily, it's just a sensation. I'm not ejaculating a lifetime of goo into my pants. Then, the bad sensations. The biting cold, the back pain, stiff neck, the bad smells. The times you see some gore and you want to throw up. Times you actually throw up. And here, it's just a sensation, but I throw up again. Then the pain. One doesn't realize the amount of pain a normal person endures in a lifetime. Every time you bang your toe somewhere, cut yourself, burn yourself, the times you have food poisoning, the time you get slapped or punched or kicked, every toothache, the times you squeeze that pimple that fucking hurts and it pulsates for seconds before it settles down. Thank fuck these things were from a dude. So I was spared a lifetime of menstrual cramps and a couple of childbirths. It's too much anyway, and I faint. I wake up because I hear an alarm go off a few streets away from me. Honestly, the whole ordeal lasted less than 3 minutes, like the most powerful punk rock song, and I was gone for less than 10. There's no trace of the heart, no trace of blood on my clothes, or on the t-shirt that I used to wrap up the heart. I was sure that the body was gone too, but I took all the time necessary to go back to the warehouse, check, and then ride back home. Everything was gone. The body, the pool of vomit, the blood I sprayed around while trying to reach the heart. I left without cleaning anything because I knew that that would be the case, but it's nice to have tangible confirmation. Back home, my mind is lit up, but my body is exhausted. I drop on my beanbag and fall asleep there. I wake up and it's still dark. A quick check at the time and I realize that I woke up and it's already dark. The second half of the money was sent. Rent won't be a problem for a while now. Sure, I'll have to find a job to keep up appearances, but still, like Walter White pretending to wash cars while cooking blue meth. I'm back to my numb self. Yesterday, experience was too fucking much. I can't take it more than once every 2 or even 3 months. But now that I felt, I know I can't live without those 3 minutes in my life. Even if half of it is the most horrible experience you can imagine. I think I found my temporary cure and probably my career path making corpses disappear. If you ever need a body to vanish in the area of Turin, just drop me an email.